So the third example of evolution happening inside our bodies by natural selection is in the development of cancer. So the cells in our bodies, for the most part, are playing by the rules. And playing by the rules means they are sitting in a particular tissue, doing their whatever job it is that they have to do in terms of producing particular enzymes or proteins or whatever they do, and also not reproducing except when it is needed. And these cells behave as part of the team because there are all sorts of controls to make sure that they do so. And these controls are basically there to prevent the development of cancer. But with time, the cells in our bodies are going to be accumulating all sorts of mutations. A lot of these mutations are going to be detrimental for the cells and they are going to die. But some cells may acquire mutations that makes them less responsible to the controls of the body in terms of preventing them from reproducing. And these cells, in competition with other cells in the same tissue, are going to have an advantage because they are going to start reproducing using resources that other cells would have been using. And then we will have the development of a tumor. So that is a step that we see here. Then later on, when we apply chemotherapy to the tumor, these cells also are, or these cells in the tumor are able to evolve resistance to the chemotherapy. So there is going to be among the cells of the tumor variability again because mutations are going to still be happening in those cells. And also cancerous cells tend to have a tendency to be more likely to mutate than other cells in the body. And as a result of that, we have a highly variable population of cells. When we expose them to chemotherapy, just by chance, some of those are going to have some mutation that makes them so that they are not affected by the chemical agent, and those cells are going to survive. So even though we may eliminate most of the cells in the tumor, a few of those may survive and later on come to recolonize the tumor, and we have a recurrence of cancer, but this time it is a cancer that is no longer resistant to the chemical treatment. And that is the reason when we are treating cancers, we need to alternate and use different kinds of chemotherapy to keep tumors when they come back. So as in the case of bacteria, when they are evolving antibiotic resistance, we have a very similar parallel situation happening in the development of cancer. And so we can also apply in this case the principles of evolution by natural selection to try to develop methods to deal with this problem so that we can conquer cancer in some way and prevent resistance to develop. So with this, we have looked at these three examples of evolution happening within our bodies to illustrate how the process of evolution by natural selection happens. And in the last part of my talk, I just like to consider how is it that we are built and thinking about how our evolutionary history may explain why we are built the way we are. And so here is a question, and this is something that maybe many of us have faced at some point, is that we tend to choke easily. And the reason this happens is because we are less than ideally designed. It turns out that the food that goes into our mouths needs to cross the respiratory tract to get into the esophagus. So our respiratory tract crosses the digestive tract for some reason that I'm going to explain you in a second. And even though there is a valve that closes the respiratory system when food is going through to prevent choking, sometimes choking happens. So why do these two systems, the respiratory and the digestive system, cross each other? It would seem to make a lot more sense to just have made two separate tubes, and then we would never have the problem of choking. So we can blame our fish ancestors for this. We evolved from a long line of aquatic organisms that did not breathe air, and lungs were an afterthought in the process of evolution. So in our ancestral fish, the air bladder is the structure for which the lungs were derived later on in mammals, so the lungs would be here. And the gallbladder opens up underneath the esophagus, and when it became a lung, it maintained the same position. But what used to be an olfactory sac in fish now has turned into our nose, but the nose is placed above the mouth, so that now we have the situation when the nose connected with the trachea to lead to the lungs, we have the respiratory tube crossing the path that the food needs to take to go to the stomach. So for this reason, because of our evolutionary history, we are faced with this less than ideal situation. But when evolution happens, natural selection just using what is already there just to accommodate new circumstances, it doesn't go about redesigning the organisms from scratch to produce what would be an optimal or perfect design. So natural selection can simply work with the material that is already there. Another example happens during childbirth, which in humans is a fairly difficult process because babies barely fit through the birth canal when they're being born. So hopefully the video now is going to work, and we're going to see a baby being born, and we're going to see how the baby is first coming down sideways, and then it needs to turn and face backwards in order to fit through the pelvic opening, because it is so tight that the only way that the head is going to fit is by doing this twist. And then again, it's going to twist again to let the shoulders go through. So human babies barely make it through the birth canal. Why has evolution designed a system that seems to be so difficult? And especially now, we know that it is a problem. I mean, very often we need to rescue the whole system by doing a C-section. So why did a natural selection just come up with a way of just having some opening in our abdomens to have birds being born the way they are born through C-sections? And the reason for this, we can again blame our ancestors. And in this case, we have to blame our egg-laying ancestors who laid eggs through the pelvis, which, because eggs are not that large, so it's not a big problem. When they started to give birth to life offspring, like in marsupials, it is not a big problem again because the marsupials are being born at a very small size. And even in other kinds of vertebrates, the babies are not that large, so they can still fit through the pelvis. But in the case of humans, we have the problem of combining bipedal locomotion with very large heads, very large brains. And so there is a trade-off there, because we cannot make the pelvic opening a lot bigger because we need to walk upright, and so that wouldn't work. But at the same time, we need to give birth to these very large babies with these very large brains, because that's what allows us to have the sort of superior cognitive abilities that humans have. So just to illustrate this, how in, say, gorillas and chimps, there is not the size of the head of their offspring is quite a bit smaller than the pelvic opening, likewise in chimpanzees. But in humans, we are pushing the envelope of evolution of having evolved these large-headed offspring that are barely fitting through a birth canal, and that makes the process of childbirth in humans very complicated. So this illustrates a principle of evolution by natural selection, that organisms are constrained, or that evolution happens within the constraints of evolutionary history. And we say evolution is a tinker, not an engineer. It doesn't redesign organisms from scratch to make them perfectly or ideally designed. And the last example that I want to give on this has to do with another principle of evolution, which is that the natural selection can only respond to environmental change, but it cannot anticipate it. So organisms are typically adapted to their immediate past, not even to their present, and much less to their future. And this is something that may explain why we now are faced with a number of diseases, the so-called diseases of civilization, because we are living in an environment that is different from the environment in which we evolved. So our hunter-gatherer genotype may be poorly adapted to modern Western conditions. And I'll give you two examples of these. One has to do with diabetes that has increased in incidence in recent years. And the other one has to do with allergies, asthma, and also related to these autoimmune disorders, although these are not shown in this figure here. So why have these diseases been increasing in frequency in recent times? Thinking about diabetes here, there are two patterns that we need to understand. The first one is, why is it becoming so common? And also, why does the incidence of diabetes differs among different populations? So we see, for instance, that in Europeans is not very large, 2 to 8% only exhibit diabetes. Among Native American populations, those that live in the US have very high incidence of diabetes, but those that live in some developing countries, like in Chile, for instance, the diabetes in that country is not very large. And then there are populations that have undergone a recent change in their lifestyle that have gone from having no diabetes 50 years ago to having very high incidence of diabetes in the present.